बिस्मिल्लाहिर्रहमानिर्रहीम, अस्सलामुअलैकुम। वी विल कंटिन्यू विद आर कोर्स इन्वेस्टमेंट एंड पोर्टफोलियो मैनेजमेंट एंड द कोर्स कोड इज MGT531। टुडेज लेक्चर इज लेक्चर नंबर 28 एंड रेफरेंस बुक इज द सेम एज वी हैव बीन डूइंग इन द लास्ट लेक्चर, दैट इज बाय क्रिस्टीना। इट वॉज इन 2010 एंड इट इज अबाउट द इन्वेस्टमेंट एनालिसिस एंड पोर्टफोलियो मैनेजमेंट। फर्स्ट ऑफ ऑल वी विल डू द समरी ऑफ द लास्ट लेक्चर दैट वी हैव डन। In last lecture we did the decision for investment in bond, two alternative approaches for the decision for investment in the bond, strategies for investment in bonds, and we also did passive management strategy and active management strategy, and we also did the stratified sampling approach. At the end of this discussion we did the summary points in the last lecture for the whole chapter, and we also did the key terms for the whole chapter. And what are the today's contents? As far as the contents of today's lectures are concerned, they comprise of question and problems for the previous chapter and psychological. Then we will start new chapter which is about psychological aspects in the investment decision making, and overconfidence, disposition effect, and perception of the investment risk. And as far as the question and problems of the last lecture are concerned. And we completed the last chapter in the last lecture, which was lecture number 27. We did the key terms as well, and however we will do the question and answers and question and problems of the last lecture in this lecture. Question number 1 is how the zero coupon bonds provide returns to investor. Question number 2 is any mortgage bond or asset any mortgage bond or asset backed security necessarily a more secure investment than any debenture comment. Question number 3 is what features of the euro bond make euro bond attractive bonds for the issuers and investors. Question number 4 is what is the purpose of the bond ratings. It is if the bond rating are so important to the investor, why do not common stock investors focus on quality rating of the companies in the making of their investment decisions. Question number 5 is how would you expect interest rate to respond to the following economic events. What would be the decision of the what would be the direction of the interest rate changes, explain why. Part A is interest increase in the investment. Part 2 is increase in saving level. Part C is decrease in exports. Part D is decrease in imports. Part E is increase in government spending, and part F is increase in taxes. Question number 6 is distinguish between an interest rate anticipation swap and a substitution swap. Question number 7 is what is likely factor in analyzing bonds and why. Question number 8 is distinguish between yield to call and yield to maturity. And question number 9 is what is the difference between the market expectation theory and the liquidity preference theory. Now we will start chapter number 6, that is about psychological aspects in the investment decision making. Psychological aspects in the investment decision making, the minimum many contents are overconfidence, disposition effect, perception of the investment risk, mental accounting and investing, emotions and investing, and at the end of the chapter we will do the summary and key terms and question and problems of the chapter. As far as the psychological aspects in investment decision making is concerned, the finance and investment decisions for some decades in the past are based on the assumption that people make rational decisions and are unbiased in their predictions about the future. The modern portfolio theory as well as other theories such as CAMP model and APT presented in last chapter 3. That we did these two models in the chapter number 3 and was developed following these assumptions. But we all know that that sometimes people act in obvious irrational way and they do the mistakes in their forecast of the future. Investor could be the case of irrational actor. For example, people usually are risk averse, but the investor will take the risk if the expected return is sufficient. We can say that people make investment as far as their portfolio are concerned according to different conditions and according to different situations. For example, sometimes they have to make the rational decisions for the portfolio holdings, but sometimes they make the irrational decisions because the mistakes which are prevailing in the forecast and prediction of the future returns, and that is why they take the irrational actions. And some people are mostly they are risk averse, and investors, they are risk taker in order to earn the higher expected returns of the of their investments. Continue with the discussion. Over the past decades, the evidence that psychologically and emotional influence both financial and investment decisions became more and more convincing. Today, are not psychologists but the economists as well agree that investors can be irrational, and the predictable decisions errors can affect the changes in the market. So it is very important to understand actual investors' behavior and psychological biases that affect their decision making. In this chapter, some important psychological aspects and the characteristics of investors' behavior are discussed. Overconfidence is the important point. Overconfidence causes people to overestimate their knowledge, to overestimate their risk and other abilities to control events. Interestingly, people are more overconfident when they feel like they have control of the outcome, even when this is clearly not the case, just the illusion. This perception occurs in investing as well. Even without information, people believe the stocks they own will perform better than stock they do not own, and this is their belief that this is definitely based on the psychological aspects of the people, that whatever they have is not so well as they do not have. However, however, ownership of a stock only gives the illusion of having control of performance of the stock. Typically, investors expect to earn an above on average return. And investing is a difficult process. It involves gathering information analysis and decision making based on that information. And as far as the psychology is concerned, we have to use our psyche, we have to use our wisdom and our thinking in order to analyze the situation for the better achievement of the portfolio holdings and for the decision making which is proper in order to purchase different assets and stocks and bonds for the portfolio set. And we have to keep our analysis and decisions on the basis of the proper information and full information and information analysis and that we have acquired. However, overconfidence causes us to misinterpret the accuracy of the information and overestimate our skills in analyzing it. So, overconfidence is basically one aspect which overestimates the situation, which overestimates the knowledge of the person, and with the help of which we overestimate and overassess the reality. And with the help of the overassess, we basically mislead and misinterpret the accuracy of the information and our knowledge and our skills and our information we have acquired. It occurs after people experience some success. Self attribution bias leads people to believe that success are attributed to skill while failure is attributed by bad luck. Therefore, we can say this is another important aspect that we have been believing, that if we are successful in doing something, we are successful in obtaining our and acquiring and meeting our objective and goal, we can say that this is our skill and this is based on our knowledge and this is due to our hard work. And if we are failure in achieving our goal and achieving our success, we can say the failure is attributed to the bad luck. It was the result of our bad luck. It was the outcome of our bad luck that we could not achieve our goal. After some success in the market, investors may exhibit overconfident behavior. This is another important aspect, that when we achieve the success and as an investor, if we have returns, as successful returns out of our investment decisions, we may say that and we may become as an investor overconfident with respect to our decision that we have made and out of which we have gained good returns. We can say that it was our decision, it was our knowledge, it was our wisdom that we were successful and we got a higher level of return. Discussing the overconfidence, after some success in the market, investors may exhibit overconfident behavior. Overconfidence can lead investors to poor trading decision, which often manifest themselves as excessive trading risk taking and ultimately portfolio losses. So what happens as a result of this overconfidence, that when some investor is successful and reap certain return out of the investment, he becomes overconfident about his investment and think that he has made such a good decision as far as his investment and portfolio is concerned. And what happens, he starts taking risk and he started to invest in such portfolios which are ultimately leading to losses. And their overconfidence increasing the amount they trade because it causes them to be certain about their opinions. And investors' opinion derived from their beliefs regarding accuracy of information they have obtained and their ability to interpret. And they think that what they have chosen as investment, the part of portfolio is absolutely right. And they believe on their beliefs and on their information and on their opinion. And they think that what they are doing is good, and as a result what happened that they started taking the risky assets and starting to invest in the risky objects, and it will ultimately lead to the portfolio losses. And overconfident investors believe more strongly in their own evaluation of a stock and concern themselves less about the believers of the others. Consider an investor who receives accurate information and is highly capable of interpreting it. The investor's high frequency of trading should result in higher returns due to high skillful and quality of information. In fact, these returns should be high enough to beat a simple buy and hold strategy while covering the cost of the trading. On the other hand, if the investor does not have superior ability but rather is suffering from a dose of overconfidence, then the high quality frequency of turnover will not result in portfolio returns large enough to beat the buy and hold strategy and cover cost. And overconfidence based trading is hazard when it comes to accumulating wealth. So we can see here the positive aspect of having the proper information, having the full skills and wisdom in while taking the investment and making any type of purchases. And definitely the investor will be likely to have positive outcome of the debt. However, if the investor is just having the overconfidence and is having the information which is not proper and is not properly skillful person when taking the decision as far as the investment or purchase is concerned, and it will lead to the loss, and she will be able to just cover the cost of investment. And we can say that overconfidence is bad thing when, and it is a sort of hazard when the investor is likely to trade in order to accumulate the wealth, and he is crazy to accumulate the wealth and is overconfident and in order to undertake the investments. And high commission costs are not the only problem caused by excessive trading. It has been observed that overconfidence leads to trading too frequently as well as the purchase the wrong stocks. And what happens that when we want to accumulate the wealth and we are on the course of accumulation of the wealth and we become overconfident as an investor, we do our trade in haste and frequently. We make the purchases and we trade frequently in the market, and sometimes and often it happens that we purchase the wrong stocks and we sell our stocks at the wrong time. For example, we can say that we purchase the stocks which are not likely to give us more benefit, and purchase them at when their prices are at higher levels, and we are likely to sell our assets when their prices are at low level. So overconfidence can also cause the investor to sell a good performing stock in order to purchase a poor one. So what is the another harm or negative aspect of overconfidence that the investor is likely to sell his good stock and good returning stock in order to purchase a bad stock and bad one and stock and the stock which is likely to perform bad. If many investors suffer from overconfidence at the same time, then signs might be found within the stock market. For example, we can say if there are a number of the investors who are suffering from the problem of overconfidence and they are likely to take their decisions in haste, and frequently they do the wrong decision, they make the wrong purchases and they do the sales at the wrong time, and the overall impact emerge in the stock market, and we can say that stock market will not show a good result and will not show a good overall outcome. Specifically, after the overall stock market increases, many investors may attribute their successes to their own skills and become overconfident. And as far as the functioning and trading in the stock market is concerned, we can say that when we are suffering from the overconfident, what we do if we are successful out of our investments and we have the a lot of return from our purchases and sales, in other words, from the trade, we can say that our success is the result of our skill, it is the result of our knowledge, it is the result of our information and right decisions as far as the trading is concerned, and we become overconfident as a result. And this overconfidence will lead us to greater trading by a large group of investors and may impact overall trading volume on the stock exchanges. And alternatively, overall trading is lower after market declines, and investors appear to attribute the success of the good period of to their own skill and begin trading more and more. And poor performance makes them less overconfident and is followed by the lower trading activity. What happens that when we are overconfident and we attribute our successes in the stock market with our skills and with our wisdom and knowledge, and we are frequently involved in the trading, we do the purchase and sale on frequent basis, and we become overconfident. However, when we suffer from the situation when we are likely to have loss, or we are likely to earn less earning, and we are likely to just bear our cost of investment, we become less confident and are therefore followed by the low trading activity, and our level of activity in the trade in the stock market will go down. Overconfidence also affects the investors' risk-taking behavior. Rational investors try to maximize returns while minimize the amount of risk. And as far as the behavior of the rational investor is concerned, they want to maximize their returns and they want to maximize their outcome, and while they want to minimize their level of risk. And this is the optimizing behavior. We can say that the rational investors, they are optimizer, and they want to take optimizing decision. However, or overconfident investors, they misinterpret the level of risk they take. And this misleading and results, and this lead to misleading results, and this misinterpretation or wrong interpretation of the level of the risk may lead to loss as a result. After all, if an investor is confident that the stocks picked will give a higher return, then there is a risk. The portfolio of overconfident investor will have higher risk for two reasons. That is, if a person is overconfident and he has invested in a portfolio, then the investor will have a risk for two basic reasons. What are those reasons? The first important reason is that the tendency to purchase higher risk stock. He becomes so confident he will not hesitate while buying the high risky stock, and he will start investing in the high risky stock. And high risk stocks, they are generally from smaller new companies. And second reason is a tendency to diversify their portfolio. And who is basically taking the high risk? These are new companies or new investor in the stock market, and those who do not have a lot of experience. These are those investors who do not have lot of information in order to invest and in order to make the profitable investment. And second reason is that they do not diversify their portfolio. And this second reason tells us that when they are keeping one type of assets in their portfolio, then they will be likely to undertake a risk, and they will be likely to face a downturn in their returns. And rather, it is better for the investors to diversify their portfolio and to invest in a number of items to keep in the stock of investment, in the stock of portfolio. Prevalent risk can be measured in several ways. Portfolio volatility, beta, and size of the firms in the portfolio. So what is prevalent risk? Prevalent risk basically is indicated with the help of portfolio volatility. That is, when there is volatility observed in the portfolio, that is the holdings of the portfolio, they are volatile frequently, the investor is likely to bring sharp fluctuations in the keepings of the portfolio or the keepings of the items in his portfolio set. and he undertake a frequent purchases and sales of different type of the item, different type of the stocks, and he is likely to make the fluctuations and the innovations in his portfolio holdings. Then is the value of the beta and the size of the firms in the portfolio. That what type of what is the size of the firm, what is the level of economic status of the firm who is investing in the portfolio. Portfolio volatility measures the degree of ups and downs in the portfolio experience. This basically tells us that if an investor is taking a number of trades and he is frequently making purchases and sales in order to keep the items in his portfolio, so we can say volatility is observed. कि वो अपने अपने portfolio में नई चीज़ें डालता है और नई चीज़ें डालता है, कुछ purchase करता है, कुछ sale करता है. Frequently जो है individual is observing and is doing experience of purchases and sale. और this such a portfolio is known as volatile portfolio. And high volatility portfolio exhibit dramatic swings in the prices and are indicative of under diversification. के individual जो है उसका और high volatility in portfolio is results from the under diversification. कि उसके portfolio items में diversification नहीं है. He is keeping his investment in one or two or few items and few stocks, and there is no variety observed in his portfolio or his purchase of these portfolio items is concerned and is linked with the swings and with the sharp fluctuations in the prices. And higher value of beta of portfolio indicate that security has high risk and will exhibit more volatility than the stock market in general. The overconfidence comes partially from the illusion of the knowledge. This refers to the tendency for the people to believe that the accuracy of their forecast increases with more information. That is, more information increases one's knowledge about something and improves one's decision. And ye or overconfidence jo hai uski illusion hoti hai. He thinks that because he is overconfident, he has an illusion of the knowledge. He thinks that he has a lot of knowledge, lot of information, but this is not the reality. This is his illusion, and he has the tendency to believe that his knowledge is accurate, his information is accurate. And when he thinks this, and more information increases one's knowledge something and improves decision. However, he thinks that his knowledge is enough, he undertakes his decision for the investment, and he does not like to take more information. However, acquiring more and more information is important to increase the knowledge of the person and to take the good decisions. And individual can use the internet today in order to make the in order to acquire a huge information and huge level of information in order to have the broader context decisions, and can take his decisions in a broader way, in a broader scenario, and with the help of lot of information. And definitely such decisions will be right and will lead the individual towards the right way. This information includes historical data. For example, we can say if individual is likely to have a lot of information, what type of information he can have in order to guide himself as an investor and as a good investor, as a rational investor, to keep his portfolio items. And this help can be taken from the historical data. For example, if we want to analyze the market situation, he can observe the variables in prevailing in the market which are necessary and which are the forces to indicate the behavior of the trade in the market. And these data can be about the past price levels, past returns level, the firm operational performance, as well as current information such as real time news and prices. However, most individual investors lack the training and experience of professional investors, and therefore are less sure of how to interpret this information. That is, this information does not give them as much knowledge about the situation as they think, because they do not have training to interpret it properly. Many individual investors realize that they have a limited ability to interpret investment information, so they use the internet for the help. And investors can get analyst recommendations prescribed to the two expert services, join new groups in order to increase the level of the information. However, online investors need to take what they see on the screen, but not all the recommendations really are from experts. And however, if investors perceive the messages as having increased their knowledge, they might be overconfident about their investment decision. However, we can say that we have the different types of sources with the help of which we can take the information, with the help of which we can take the guideline in order to make our future decisions and to undertake the further investment for our portfolios. And the important sources are net, and important sources are we join some companies, some advisors online, and some sources of information online, and all these the sources can help us, and we can also have the contact through the internet with some analysts who are good recommendations giving and good suggestions, and who are analyst of the for example, we can say who are analyst of the market situation. And if we continue the discussion, we can say that another important point for the investor psychological factor is the illusion of the control, because often believe that they have influence over the outcome of uncontrollable events. That is, they think that they can control the uncontrollable events. They are so confident that they think that they can control, and they have access, and they have this skill to overcome those situations which they cannot control. Even early positive results give the investor greater illusion of control than early negative results. And when a greater amount of information is obtained by the investor, illusion of control is greater as well. Overconfidence could be learned through the past success. And the more success the investors experience, the more they will attribute it to their ability and when much luck is involved. And we can say that when they early take the results, some positive results out of their investment, and they will become more confident and as compared to early negative results. And similarly, they can think that when they have knowledge and they have experience, and out of their investment they acquire more knowledge, more experience, and if the outcomes are positive as far as returns are concerned, they will again attribute their returns to their ability, to their wisdom, and their lot of information and knowledge which they have acquired, and to some extent they think that this may be the result of their luck, good luck as well. As a consequence, overconfident behavior will be more pronounced in bull markets than in bear markets. And you can see the Odeon 2001. It was the study done by Odeon in 2001. Then we have another important effect, which is known as disposition effect. What is this disposition effect? The people usually avoid actions that create regret and seek actions that cause pride. And this disposition effect tells us that people are likely to undertake those actions, they are likely to perform those activities which give them more pleasure, which give them more pride, than for which they have to regret, and they are likely to have discomfort. Regret is basically the emotional pain that comes with realizing that a previous decision turned out to be a bad one. So we can say that what is regret, how we can define it, it is the emotional pain or discomfort that we can feel from the outcome of our previous decision that we have made. However, what is pride? Pride is basically the emotional joy. It is the emotional pleasure of realizing that the decision they have made is turned out to be good, and the decision they have made is turned out to have high returns without any loss. And it is a pride. It is basically pleasure of enjoyment, and it is a pleasure of having success out of their decisions, out of some investment. Avoiding regret and seeking pride affects person behavior, and this is the true for investors decision too. And how we can avoid the regret and how we can seek the pride or pleasure? Basically, it is the behavior of the individual. It is the attitude of the person towards different things, towards different decisions, that they should take their decisions rationally, in rational way, so that they can and they can get a player out of them, they can get success, and they can be able to avoid the risk, and they can be able to avoid the regret out of their decisions. And Sheffrin and Statman 1985 were the first economists to show that that fearing regret and seeking pride causes the investors to be predisposed to selling winners, potential stocks with growing market prices to early and rising losers. Stocks with the negative tendencies in market prices too long, they call this the disposition effect. Do the investors behave in a rational manner by more often selling losers, or are investors affected by their psychology and have a tendency to sell their best stocks? Several empirical studies provide evidence that the investors behave in a manner more consistent with the disposition effect. So we can say that the empirical studies and outcome of empirical evidence show that the investors they behave in such a manner that are consistent with the disposition effect, that the individuals they want to avoid the return and they regret and they want to avoid the risk. And their wrong decisions outcome, rather they would like to undertake the decisions in a wise way, in a systematic pattern, with within the light of a lot of information, so that they can undertake a good decision, so that they can undertake right decisions in order to enjoy the pleasure of right decisions. Researchers like Chopra Venezia in 2010, Chen et al. In 2007, they have found the disposition effect to be pervasive. And the studies found that more recently the stock gains or losses occur, the stronger the propensity was to sell winners and hold losers. And what they, according to this study, we can say that these researchers they conducted the studies and found the result that the stockholders they undertook their decisions in such a way that they were intended to sell those stocks which were likely to give them high returns and which were likely to give them a minimum loss, and there was a greater gap and difference between the purchase price of the stock and sale price of the stock. And however, they hold the losers, and they tried to hold those assets which were at low prices and which were likely to give them loss, so that until to wait for a time when they can overcome their cost and they are likely to give the benefit to the owner of the stock. Investors usually hold in their portfolio losers remarkably longer than winner. What happens when the portfolio are concerned, and the purchase and sale with respect to portfolio items is concerned, that the rational decision maker, rational investors, they hold the losing assets for a long time, and rather than the winner winning assets, and they sell their winning assets at the time when they are indicating positive trend and the peak positive price, rather than the assets which are showing the downfall in the price and in their return. The disposition effect not only predicts selling of the winners, but also suggests that the winners are sold too soon, that the losers are held too long. And we can say that to avoid the regret and to enjoy the pleasure of joy and pleasure of the good decision, disposition effects not only predicts that the individuals they sell the winners at the right time and at the peak price time, and this disposition effect also suggests the winners that they should hold their losing assets for the reasonable time period to wait. And how such investors behave does affect the potential result from his investment. Selling winners too soon suggests that those stocks will continue to perform well after they are sold, and holding losers too long suggests that their stocks will continue to perform poorly. Again, we can see that selling winners, they suggest that they will continue to perform to sell their assets and stocks which are likely to pay them more, as compared to the stockholders who think that their stocks are likely to give them and them losses and are likely to perform badly. The fear of regret and the seeking of pride can affect investors' wealth in two ways. The first way is that investors are paying more in taxes because of disposition to sell winners instead of losers. And second is that investors earn a lower return on their portfolio because they sell the winners too early and hold poorly performing stocks that continue with decreasing market results. And interesting are the results of some other studies by Knopf Singer 2001, in which individual investors' reaction to news about the economy and about the company was investigated. So we can say that the basically these are the important type of the ways with the help of the fear of the regret and those who are seeker of the pride and the player affect their wealth in through the investment in two ways that they pay more in the form of the taxes because of disposition to sell winner instead of loser. This is the one important reason behind this, the fear of avoiding the fear of regret and the seeking for the player of the pride and right decisions, and that they also can earn a low return on their portfolio because they sell winner too early and hold poor performing stocks that continue decreasing results. And good news about the company that increases the stock price induces the investors to sell stock and selling the winners. And what is another important aspect is that for the selling winner is that when the selling winners, they find the good news and information about the companies that is likely to increase the prices of the stock that the selling winner is likely to hold, then the selling winner will be intended to sell that stock, will be intended to sell those assets in order to earn high returns, in order to make more profits and benefits. And controversially, bad news about the firm does not induce investors to sell. For example, we can say that when the investors, they find the information that such stocks are losing their prices, are the companies issuing those stocks, they are likely to reduce the prices of those particular assets or stocks, or such stocks will be known as holding losers, and the investors will not be likely to sell those stocks, and they will be intended to hold these stocks. And this is consistent, these decisions are consistent with avoiding the regret, with avoiding the displeasure and unhappiness, and they will seek the pleasure, they will seek the happiness, they will seek the relaxation and comfort and psychological relaxation. And this is known as these are the important aspects of disposition effect. However, news about the company does not induce investors trading. For example, we can say that the economy news, if we are having any news about the economic situation and overall macroeconomic indicator, that does not induce the investor to trade. Neither the fluctuations in the macroeconomic variables, they neither induce the investor to trade in terms of purchasing or nor in terms of sale of the assets. And investors are likely to are less likely than usual to sell winners after good economic news, and these results are not consistent with the disposition effect. Therefore, we can say that they are investors, as we have discussed earlier, that when there are fluctuations in the macroeconomic situation, then the investors are not more likely to associate their investments and trade with those fluctuations in the macroeconomic variables, that after having the good news, they are less likely to sell their assets, which are winning assets, and they are, as a result of the hearing the bad news, they are not likely to hold their bad giving assets. And how much results could be explained? Investors' actions are consistent with the disposition effect for company news because the feeling with the disposition effect of regret is strong. And we can say that the above discussion that we have made, that the macroeconomic fluctuations, that they are not likely to induce the investors to sell winning assets and to hold the bad assets or losing assets. Now, this is may not be consistent and may not be associated with the disposition effect, and the investors' actions, they are consistent with the disposition effect, that is, they want to avoid the loss and they want to reap the maximum benefit and maximum profit. And for the company news, because the feeling with the disposition of the regret is strong. And this is so because that they are associated with this position effect because they feel a great displeasure out of their decisions with respect to losing assets, that is a sense of that, and that indicates a feelings of regret, and they have a strong pleasure out of the good decisions. In the case of economic news, investors have a weaker feeling of regret because the outcome is considered beyond their control, and as far as the economic and macroeconomic situation is concerned, because the particular investor cannot influence the macroeconomic situation through his purchase or sale and through his trade in the financial market or in the bond market or in the stocks market, then they have little feelings of regret and they have little feelings of unhappiness or displeasure because they know that they cannot control and they are not in a position to control the situation, such a situation which is indicating the bad performance of macroeconomic variables due to the internal economic and political factors and external economic and political factors. They feel little displeasure because they consider that the situation is out of their control and they cannot streamline the macroeconomic situation. And this leads to action that are not consistent with the prediction of the disposition effect. And what happens consequently that the investors will do will perform in such a way and it cannot be considered consistent and relevant with the predictions of the disposition effect. And perception of the investment risk. Now we will do the perception of the investment risk. That what is the perception of the investment risk? And we have been discussing investment risks so many times when we discuss the investment in the portfolio items, and when we continue to discuss in the stock market and continue to discuss the purchase and sale in the bonds market and in the financial market, people perception of risk appears to vary. We can say that risk perception of the different individuals different with respect to their perceptions. One important factor in evaluating a current risk decision is a past outcome. How we can perceive that a situation is risky, or economic factor or the behavior of the economic variable is risky, or such a type of the trend of the returns of the any particular type of asset is risky. One important factor which can help us to evaluate the risky situation depends upon the past trends of the return of any particular asset of any particular stock, and the past behavior and past trends of the returns of any asset can provide a guideline to the investor that whether this investment is risky or have been risky or not have been beneficial and fruitful. And people are willing to take more risk after earning gains and less risk after losses. So what happens that they are likely to take more risk when they have capital gain, when they have earning gains, or in other words, we can say that after having the profit, they are courageous enough to take the risk, and rather than when they are incurring losses. So we can say when they are happy, when they are enjoying their positive outcomes of their decisions, they are likely to take the risk and they are likely to face the risk associated with their future investments and future decisions of the portfolio investment. And however, they are likely to take less risk when they bear the loss, when they are likely to incur loss after certain decisions about the investment. After experiencing a gain or profit, people are willing to take more risk. So in other words, we can say, in simple words, we can say that they are likely to gain a profit, and they after gaining a profit or after gaining a gaining benefit, they are willing and they are intending to have and to face and to bear more level of risk, and they are likely to purchase such items, such stocks which are associated with high risk. After gaining a big sum of money in gambling, people do not fully consider the new money as their own, and even then they can take the risky decisions. So when they are taking additional risk, they act as if they gamble with opponent's money and casino money. This is called a house money effect. And what is house money effect? This house money effect basically predicts that the investors are more likely to purchase high risk and after locking in gain by selling stocks at a profit level. And what house money effect is? This effect tells us that, for example, if they have gained a lot out of the gamble, and they do not worry and they do not fear of losing their earned money, but they are likely to take additional risk and they gamble with the opponent's money. They use this money and they start again gambling, and this is the house money effect. And this effect tells us that investors are more likely to buy the risky stocks after having gained by the selling stocks at the profit level or at the beneficial rate. And after experiencing a financial loss, people become less willing to take a risk. So another important situation is that they are reluctant to gain a risk. They are individual are reluctant to invest in such assets out of which they think that they will get a loss, or they will experience a loss, or which is likely to be risky. This effect is recognized as snakeable effect. The people remember this for a long time and become cautious. Likewise, after having their money lost, people often feel they will be able to unsuccessful in the future too, and they avoid taking risk in their investment decisions. For example, if they undertake a gamble and they face a loss in gamble, they will not they will avoid to undertake further risks, and they will avoid to play further gamble, because they think that if they undertake further gamble, they will lose the remaining money and they will not be able to recover the situation. They will be unsuccessful in the future, and therefore they would avoid to take risk in their investment decisions. And for example, picking new stocks to the portfolio can give better diversification of the investor's portfolio. However, after having the losses in their decisions, and after having losses as a result of their investment decisions, and as a result of their outcomes of their decisions, they think that they should buy a new asset, they should buy new stocks which are not relevant to the existing stocks kept in their portfolio. In order, and the objective is to minimize their risk and minimize loss out of their purchases and out of their selections. And the objective is to maximize their overall benefit, because they have already had a loss and risk in their portfolio. And they pick new stocks in this situation to keep in their portfolio, because they think that the stock is diversified, portfolio is diversified, and they can hope to earn returns out of it. Even if the newly purchased stocks quickly decline in price, the investors might feel the snake bite effect and can be afraid of picking stocks in his portfolio in the future. But we can observe that sometimes losers do not avoid risk. And what is that situation? Then the losers use the chance to make up their losses. Sometimes it happens that when they bear a loss in their as a result of their choices, and already they have a loss, and second time when they invest in the risky asset, they have again lost. This is known as, and they feel a snake bite effect, and they are too much afraid of the outcome of their investment, and they feel that they will have negative impact of this of their decision in the future time period. But when they do not avoid the risk, taking the risk, even if they keep a loss and they face a loss, then the losers use the chance to make up their losses, because they take the risky assets again and they invest in the risky stocks, because the risky stocks, they are associated with the higher returns, and they want to acquire the chance in order to overcome their losses, in order to overcome their cost. And continuing with the discussion, we find that the need for breaking even becomes to be stronger than the snake bite effect. People without significant gains or losses prefer not to take the risk. They are neutral investors. For example, they can be those who do not have any neither loss nor gains out of their investment. They avoid to take risk, so that they do not lose their income. Examining the risk of the investor, the endowment effect must be mentioned too. And we can say that when we examine the risk associated with the portfolio holdings of the investor, there is another important important type of effect which is known as endowment effect. It must be included and discussed here. And endowment effect is when people demand much more to sell things when they would be willing to pay to buy it. And closely related to the endowment effect is the status quo bias, that is the behavior of the people when they try to keep what they have been given instead of exchanging. And how can endowment of the status or the status quo bias affect investors? People have tendency to hold the investments they already have, and the status quo bias increases as the number of investment options increases. And the status quo bias behavior of the people show that they want to keep and they want to buy what they have been given instead of the exchanging. And we can say that this endowment effect indicates that individuals are likely to hold similar type of the stocks. They are likely to purchase similar type of the assets which they have been having already, and they do not want to try a new and diversified assets and stocks in order to avoid the risk. This is the endowment type of stock, and this means that the more complicated the investment decision that was needed becomes, the more likely the person is to choose to do nothing. In the real world, investors face the choice of the investment in these thousands of the company stocks, bonds, and other investment choices. And we can say that the more complex and complicated nature of the investment decisions they are undertaken by the individuals, because people they want to choose those complicated investments. And in the reality of the life, or we can say in the practical world, investors they face the choice of investing in thousands of company stocks, bonds, and other investment vehicles. And all these possibilities may affect the investors, and as a result, they often choose to avoid making a change. And when they have invested in a number of stocks, in a number of bonds, in a number of other investment vehicles and the equipments, and they continue to make those choices, and they avoid the possibility of choosing in other assets, this can be a particular problem when the investments have lost money. And they do not change their choices, because when they think if they have a better experience with those particular type of stocks and bonds and other investment, they will continue their investment, and they will continue their decisions with those similar purchases rather than diversifying, rather than trying a new stocks and innovative stocks in order to avoid the risk. And we can observe such a behavior of investors during the last years, and this such a behavior can be observed from the data of the of different variables that can be acquired from the financial market variables. And closely related with the memory problems affecting the investor behavior is cognitive dissonance. Cognitive dissonance is another type of the behavior that the investors are likely to show. And cognitive dissonance is based on evidence that the people are struggling with two opposite ideas in their brains. I am nice, but I am not nice. And they have two opposite ideas which are conflicting with each other. The individual thinks that he is a good decision maker, and on the same time the idea comes to his mind that he is not a good decision maker. He thinks that he is more skillful, and besides, idea comes to his mind that he is not more skillful. So you avoid these are the psychological and emotional fluctuations which individual faces. To avoid psychological pains, people use to ignore or reject any information that contradicts with their positive self-image. The avoidance of cognitive dissonance can affect the investor's decision-making process. And this is the 2 days lectures end. And at the end of the lecture, we will discuss the summary point at what we have done in today's lecture. And then we will finish our lecture. And in today's lecture, basically, we started the psychological aspects in the investment decision making, and we did the concept of overconfidence, disposition effect, and perception of investment risk, and different other effects associated with the individual decision making about the investment. And we came to know that overconfident causes people to overestimate their knowledge, risk, and their ability to control events. And the people are more overconfident. They feel that they have control of the outcomes, even if in reality they cannot control. And this will be the illusion of them and not anything else. And this perception occurs in investing as well, and as far as the investment is concerned. And without any complete information, people believe that stocks they own will perform better than stocks they do not own. And this is their decision, that they think that what they have owned and what they have purchased is the better return given rather than the other. And ownership of stock only gives the illusion of having control of performance of the stock. And they think that information analysis that they have is good, and they have good information and required level of proper information, and they sometimes misinterpret the accuracy of the information and overestimate their skills and overestimate the returns they are likely to have out of their investments. It occurs after people experience some successes. And what happens when they are having some successes? They think that they are likely to and that their successes are likely to be attributed to their success and their skills and information, and the failures they are the result of their bad luck. And overconfidence can lead individual to poor trading decisions, and it increases the amount they trade because it causes them to be certain about their opinions, and they basically think that that their information they have acquired is accurate, and they have the ability to interpret their information. And on the other hand, if the investor does not have the superior ability but rather is suffering from dose of overconfidence, that high frequency of the turnover will not result in portfolio returns and enough to beat the buy and hold strategy. And overconfidence is based trading is a hazard when it comes to accumulating the wealth. And we can say it alternatively, overall trading is lower after market declines. Investors appear to attribute the success of good period of their own skills and begin trading more. And overconfidence also affect the individual risk-taking behavior. Rational investors want to maximize the return and minimize the risk, and however confident investors do not do this. And we can say that the overconfidence becomes partially from the illusion of the knowledge. This refers to the tendency for the people to believe that the accuracy of their forecast increases with more information. That is, more information increases one knowledge about something and improve one decision. And this information includes historical data, such as the data or different macroeconomic variables, and they are less sure of how to interpret this information. That is, this information does not give them much knowledge about the situation they think, because they do not have training to interpret it properly. And many investors, they realize that they have limited ability to interpret the information, so they use the other information sources. For example, they use the internet, and they take the help of other prescription. They prescribe with themselves with other analysts and with other experts, and so that they can have proper information for the situation prevailing in the market. And we can say that another important type of the investor psychological factor is illusion of the control. People often believe that they have influence over the outcome of uncontrollable events, and early positive results give the investor greater illusion of control than early negative results. And when a greater amount of information is obtained by the investor, illusion of control is greater as well. And overconfidence could be learned through the past success. The more success the individual experience, more they will attribute their success towards their own ability, their own skill and information and knowledge, and a part of it will be attributed to good luck. And we have many studies which have worked in this respect. For example, Odin 2001 studied the overconfident behavior of the individual, and then we have disposition effect. As far as disposition effect is concerned, we have two types of the factors. One is known as regret, and the other type of feeling is the feeling of the joy, which is known as the feeling of the pride as well. Regret is basically the emotional pain that comes out of wrong decisions, and pride is the emotional joy of realizing that good decision turned out well. And this is the disposition effect. Number of studies have worked about this. For example, Statman and the Sheffrin worked about this at in 1985. And then we have the other studies and researchers. For example, Venezia conducted study in 2001 and Chen et al. In 2007, and they found that the more recently the stock gains or losses occur, the stronger the propensity to sell winners and hold losers. So we can say when the prices, according to the study, when the prices of the stocks they are likely to go upward, then the investors they will be likely to sell those assets, and they will like to hold the losing assets rather than the winning assets. As far as the perception of the investment is concerned, we can say that one important factor in evaluating the current risky situation is past behavior of the variables and past behavior of returns of different assets, and people are willing to take more risk even after having more gain, and they are less likely to undertake the risky assets after having losses out of them. After gaining, for example, big sum of the money in gambling, people do not fully consider the new money as their own, and even then they take the additional risk and they act as if they gamble with the opponent money. And this type of effect is known as house money effect. The house money effect basically indicates that investors are more likely to purchase risky assets and after locking in gain by selling stocks at a profit, and after experiencing a loss, people become less willing to take risky assets. And when they are likely to even take risky assets after having the loss, and they again have a loss, and this type of effect is known as snake bite effect. And examining the risk of the investor, the endowment effect is another important effect. And this endowment effect is when people demand much more to sell things than they would be willing to do to pay to buy it. And we can say that endowment or co-bus effect, people have the tendency to hold the investment they already have, and rather than investing in diversified and new type of the asset, they would like to keep those assets which they have been investing in the previous time period or in the past, so that to avoid the risk and the to avoid the losses in the future time period. This was the end of the 2 days lecture, and I think you will be able to understand the lecture in the light of the discussion over here, in the light of the studies, and in the light of the reading materials that we will provide to you. And take care of yourself. Up to next lecture. Allah Hafiz.